So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as most of you would be knowing that in this series, we try to discuss some concepts that are related to finance and economics, current affairs, and they can be really helpful in your preparation for competitive exams, right? So I hope you're ready for today's session. And before moving to question number one, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if you are new here and watching this video for first time, so guys, don't forget to hit the subscribe button. It can help you to stay in touch with us and it can get you access to a lot of good content that can be really helpful in your exams preparation. And don't forget to press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. It can help you to stay in touch with us, right? After that, don't forget to join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. And since we are talking about doubts and queries, so guys, all those of you who have asked for different videos links in the comments, please do check it. Recently, there have been replies on many comments, so you can check it, right? So moving ahead to question number one for today, and I hope the screen is perfectly visible. Okay, let me read this question. This question says, analysts broadly define the profile of a dash trader as young professionals between ages of 20 and 30 with little prior experience in trading and who use commission or brokerage free trading applications to try their hand in stock market. So guys, see, this question talks about an investor who is a new investor, or you can say a rookie investor who has no prior experience or very little prior experience in trading, right? So you have to tell what is this new term which is being used for such investors, such traders. So this is not a technical term, but more of a lingo which is getting popular in financial world, right? So let's move ahead to the correct option for this question. And the correct option for this question is option A. Option A means Robin Hood trader. Right, so it's very interesting that how it gets its name, Robin Hood trader. So basically there is an app called Robin Hood which allows trading for young people. So it basically focuses on youth and tries to get them into stock market. So it's very popular in US and it has got so many young people investing into stocks, right? And see, more it has more become a trend, or you can say that people are really enjoying day-to-day trading. They are selling, they are buying and making short-term profits rather than going for some long-term investment. So this Robinhood company, they have allowed young people to get into this world of stock market, right? So from that company, which is called Robinhood, comes this term Robinhood trader. Basically, a young person who is trading into stock market more because of fun. Okay, they are making financial gains, but the main reason is that they are getting adrenaline rush out of it. They are getting fun out of it, right? So, and after that, this pandemic, which has given them so much time to sit at their homes, and even if people are working from homes, they are saving time in commuting. So basically, they are trying, young professionals who have time and who earlier didn't have any interest in trading, now they are trying to learn new skills, and one of this new skills is investing into stock market, right? You can see here, basically a newbie into this world of stock trading, and coronavirus has helped to increase this trend. So basically, a person whose savings rose as he cut down spending on things like travel, entertainment, since you cannot go out because of the pandemic, commute, shopping, etc. So many people, they have saved on, okay, we agree that there's a major chunk of society which is facing financial distress and even a crisis for survival. But there is one segment which is very settled, who are conveniently sitting at their homes, getting their salaries on time or working from home, and even they are saving money, right? So they are trying to put this money into some use, and one of this usage is to put them into stock market and learning the different aspects of trading. Stuck at home with extra money, turn to internet to learn about stock market and investing to make a quick buck, right? Okay, you can see here, such investors have proliferated in India also. So not only in US, so basically this company, Robinhood company, this has prevalence in US, but now this trend is coming into India also. So guys, I think you must remember that we have discussed a lot many times in our sessions that how the number of DMAT accounts which are used for trading, so these DMAT accounts, the number for them has suddenly rose during this duration of the pandemic, right? So that shows you that people are interested and people are taking interest in stock market, and rather than going for some traditional means like investing into a mutual fund or taking an SIP, they are getting kick out of investing into stock markets directly, right? So in India also, and it obviously it is a global trend now getting popular in India. So these individuals are not particularly seeking out value in the market, but more preoccupied with making quick returns and discounts. And the point is, there are many platforms which are making this easy for them with the help of using their cell phones and with the help of online applications. It is very easy, and the commission charged by these platforms is very less. That is why these are the reasons which are drawing these young professionals to stock market. You can see here, Zerodha reported 300% bump in new monthly account openings. People are opening new accounts. Even Motilal Oswal, they saw their downloads of mobile app increase by 50%. IIFL, Angel Broking, all are reporting in similar manner, right? So I hope now you get what is a Robinhood trader. So one more fact, this Robinhood trading, this is getting really popular in cryptocurrency aspect also. So this is a very very prevalent term where young people are getting drawn towards this cryptocurrency investing, right? Moving ahead to second question for today. Okay, here is your question number 2 for today, which says, out of the statements mentioned below in your site, select the correct statements about divine coincidence. So you have to select the correct statement which tells you something correct about a concept called divine coincidence. So guys, you can pause the video here, read the statements carefully, and then try to interpret them and select your answer, right? Moving ahead to the solution for this question. Here is the solution which says that the correct option is option D. Option D means divine coincidence states that there is no trade-off between stabilization of inflation and stabilization of the welfare relevant output gap for central banks. So guys, this seems a little complicated, but it is a very simple economic concept that we know, that we learn about many a time. So do you remember when we talked about Phillips curve or Pigou effect? In all these things, we talked about how this mechanism of inflation and unemployment, these are self-correcting mechanisms, right? So if you remember when we talked about Phillips curve also, we said that inflation is having an inverse relationship with unemployment, right? So inflation and unemployment, these two variables, they have negative relationship between them, because if unemployment falls, that means people are getting more work, and if they are getting more work, which means more income. More income means more demand for goods and services, which leads to inflation, right? So low unemployment means high inflation, and the opposite is also true. So basically, this relationship is related to divine coincidence. Now, what this divine coincidence is telling you, why did we revise this relationship of Phillips curve? Guys, do you remember that we also talked about how Phillips curve used to be really prevalent in the last century, but after that, when economists, they started to observe the concept of stagflation. So they saw that it is not necessary that if unemployment is low, inflation has to be high, or if unemployment is high, inflation has to be low. They can move in same direction also in a scenario called stagflation. So in stagflation, what happens is the inflation is high and even the unemployment is also high, right? So you see that there is a positive relationship between inflation and unemployment in the case of stagflation, which basically which gave us a different perspective, which was not covered by the Phillips curve, right? So this Phillips curve concept of negative relationship is related to divine coincidence. Now this divine coincidence, it says that if there is a central bank which is trying to control inflation or trying to stabilize inflation, it will automatically stabilize the gap between welfare relevant output. That means the difference between potential output, which economy has the potential to achieve, to output simply here means the goods and services produced. So economy has a potential output and actual output. So this divine coincidence, this concept says that if central banks, they try to control inflation, they try to stabilize inflation, they end up stabilizing the output gaps also, right? So it's not like that they have to control two things simultaneously. If they are successful in controlling one thing, they end up controlling the other thing also, right? Because of their self-correcting mechanism. You can see here in the solution. So inflation targeting central banks usually benefit from what some economists have labeled a divine coincidence. This is when best policy response to inflation also turns out to be best in response to unemployment, right? A central bank should raise its policy rate when inflation is high and unemployment is low. So this is what usually central banks do. But see, this concept of divine coincidence, currently we are not facing it, because if we talk about Indian scenario also, we are facing stagflation. And if our central bank RBI is trying to control inflation, it would have a negative impact on the output, right? So they have to think of some other measures to think of output or to control the output also, or to have a positive impact on the output also, right? So that is why we are saying that in current scenario, this divine coincidence that central banks, okay, they can just go for controlling the inflation and output would be controlled by its own self, or unemployment would be taken care by its own. So this is not the current situation. Now the central bank under stagflation situation has to manage both the aspects, right? You can see. However, this coincidence rarely occurs. Emerging market economies in India, like India, they frequently face temporary supply shocks, which leads to increase in prices or increase in inflation, which moves output and inflation both in the same, both in the opposite direction, resulting in high inflation and low output, right? I hope this is clear to you. Monetary policy thus pays a dilemma or a trade-off whether to choose output over inflation. So as you can see also that in current situation, RBI has to select one or the other thing, that if they want to control inflation, they would have to sacrifice some of the growth part, because due to the measures that it will take to control inflation, that can have negative impact on our growth, right? So they will have to maintain a trade-off, which if divine coincidence was present, this would not have happened, because because if RBI would have targeted inflation, it would have simultaneously controlled the output also, right? Moving ahead to the next question for today. And here is the third question, which says, a dash is a form of fictitious trade in which a transaction or a series of transactions give the appearance that authentic purchases and sales have been made, but where the traders have been entered without the intent to take a bona fide market position. So without the intent, this is a keyword, or without the intent to execute transactions subject to market risk or price competition. So this statement, this appears a little bit tricky, but if you break it in parts, then you would be easily able to understand it. So this says, first of all, your answer is a form of fictitious trade. It is not an actual trade, but a fake one, in which some misleading is happening, or in which the traders, they do not actually want to take positions. They are indulging into some other activities, right? Moving ahead to the solution for this question, and the solution for this question is option B, which means your correct option is wash trade. So this wash trade, it is also known as trip trading. So this was mentioned in comments by Mridula, or round trip trading. Now, what is meant by this wash trade and what significance does it have? You can see here. So basically, when some investors, they try to drive the prices up just by showing some fake transaction. So some investors, if they are just buying and selling the shares of a company just to drive its prices up, so that once the prices, they are high, they can sell their own stock at high price and after that drive the market down, right? So some sort of misleading is happening here for the other investors, because if there is a stock in which a lot of trading is happening, a lot of people are buying and selling that particular stock, that particular security, other investors might think that, okay, this is one security holding the interest of investors, right? But no one wants to take a long-term position in it, but they just want to mislead the market. So such trades are known as wash trade, which are done with the intent of misleading the market or misleading other investors. Can see here, repeated buying and selling of securities can inflate the trading volume and balance sheet figures, right? So it might not inflate the price depending upon the volume of buying and selling, but a lot of buying and selling would give an impression that investors are really interested into this particular stock, right? So this is something what Enron did. I hope that you all are aware of the Enron scam, and if you are not, then do give it a read. This is one case, this is one scam that I think we all should know about, and I think we have discussed this earlier also, that you can also watch a movie called Enron, the smartest guys in the room, that gives you it's a very nice movie that tells you the psychology behind the scam, the psychology of people who were involved in the scam, right? So coming back to the question, two main factors that would result in a transaction being categorized as a wash trade are result and intent. So if the market is misled, that is the result, and if there is an intent to dupe or intent to fool the market, to fool other traders, then that is a wash trade. So it might see, there are two investors. Investor one actually wants to buy or sell the security, and he is interested into his own trade. That is why he is buying or selling, right? So this might not count as a wash trade. But if second investor two, he has some malicious intentions, or he has an intention to mislead, and he is not interested in buying or selling, but just wants to mislead the market or just wants to inflate the trading volumes, then this would be considered as a wash trade. So two things, two factors very important. What is the result of wash trade and what was the intent behind the wash trade, right? So this is a major factor which is commonly seen in cryptocurrency exchanges. High frequency trading just to drive up the prices or at least drive up the trading volumes to leading to manipulation of prices, right? Okay, moving ahead. So here is your fourth question for today. So this question, it says that RBI on September 16 proposed to introduce exchange traded and over the counter interest rate derivatives products that would be accessible to both foreign investors and retail participants. Retail participants can however only use the product for Dash, whereas non-retail can use it for any purpose. So RBI has recently proposed that okay, let us allow interest rate derivatives products, different type of derivative products which are related to interest rates, right? So now they are saying any retail participant or any small investor who tries to invest in such products, their purposes would be limited, that they can only use this derivative products for only certain purposes, and you have to tell what are these purposes. So three are given to you: speculating, hedging and long-term saving. You have to tell out of those five options given to you here that what is the purpose for which retail participants are allowed to use these products, right? Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution for this question is option B. Option B means only two. That means retail participants, they are only allowed these products for the purpose of hedging, no other purpose. They can just use these products for hedging, or you can say as a sort of protection to their other investments or for mitigation purposes, right? Let us look at the full news. Okay, so RBI said retail participants can be allowed to trade on forward rate agreement, interest rate swaps. So guys, we have already discussed interest rate swaps in a previous session. Forward interest rates, they are quite similar to interest rate swaps, have some operational differences, but quite similar to interest rate swaps. After that, European interest rate options. So basically, these are different interest rate derivative products. Presently, only interest rate futures and interest rate options are allowed on government securities. So guys, see, these futures and these options, these are derivative products, right? So if you remember, we have discussed in detail what is the meaning of derivative, the types, forwards, futures and options in detail, right? And we have also discussed swaps, interest rate swaps. So all these terms have been already discussed. If you're not clear about them, you can first watch that video so that you can understand this question properly. And for that video, for those videos links, you can ask in the comments. Okay. So earlier only futures and options, interest rate options were allowed to be formed on government securities. So what is the underlying security here on which the derivative is to be created? Government security. After that, if other products would be allowed, other interest rate financial derivative products would be allowed, corporate debt can also be incorporated for making derivatives over the time. So do you see how RBI being a very conservative central bank, they are trying to open up a little bit. See, in India, derivatives and such risky derivatives are a very risky financial product. So such products were not in much usage, right? But gradually RBI is trying to open the economy up and allow different type of experiments to be done here. So FPIs would be allowed to transact in permitted exchange traded interest rate derivatives. So they are saying, okay, FPIs will allow them to invest in these derivatives, but only in the exchange traded interest rate derivatives. So guys, if you remember, these financial products, either they can be traded on a stock exchange or they can be traded in an OTC market. I hope we all are clear with the meaning of the term. If not, you can ask for its video in the link in the comments. For a collective ₹5,000 crore in net positions. See, they are putting a limit to the investment of FPI since they do not want risk factors to be really high. So they are saying that okay, we'll allow FPIs to invest, but they will have to invest in exchange traded products, derivative products, and there is a limit to it for a 5,000 crore net long position. So they cannot take net short positions, but only net long positions. So the resultant position should be a long position. They cannot bet. See, what is shorting? Shorting is betting on falling prices. So they cannot short the underlying securities here. They cannot short the corporate debt securities or government securities on which these derivatives are created, right? After that, resident Indian companies with a minimum net worth of 500 crore will be eligible, and such IRD transactions can be carried out on exchanges. As I just told you, if they are carried out on exchanges, there are going to be standardized products. That means common products for all the investors, whereas and exchanges have the liberty to design the products, eligible participants, product design and other details. In the OTC markets, banks and primary dealers would act as market makers. So in the OTC market, where there is no control of the exchange, who are going to act as market makers, or who are going to act as intermediaries for providing these products? Banks and other stock market dealers, right? So moving ahead to last question for today, and here is your last question for today. Okay, question number 5, it says the Union government is looking for a smooth passage of some labor codes which will be tabled in the monsoon session of parliament beginning 14 September 2020. So, monsoon session has begun, and in this session some labor codes have to be passed. You have to tell the codes which government is looking for a smooth passage of these codes, right? Very simple question. Moving ahead to the solution for this question. And the solution is E. That means all 3, 1, 2 and 3, all 3 are codes. Government is looking to pass them. Okay. So, labor codes, as you know, the tight or stringent labor norms in India is one of the deterrent which does not allow many a times big companies or big corporate giants of the world to settle their factories here, because they do not get the liberty or freedom of hiring or firing of workers, right? So these labor codes are going to change such situations, provide more freedom to the entrepreneur, or provide more freedom to the business managers in hiring and firing of the managers and dealing with other aspects of labor. You can see here codes on industrial relations, occupational safety and health and social security will allow industries to adopt flexible options in hiring and help bring new sunrise sectors employees. Sunrise sectors, the booming sectors, including platform and gig workers under social security net. So the gig workers, contractual workers, or who are freelance, who basically they do not have a timeline that okay, they have to report at office at this time, leave office at this time. So they work according to contracts, right? So they are trying to bring contractual workers and gig workers under the social security net. But there are chances that this might invite some criticism, because encouragement of gig workers or contractual employment would mean anyhow suppressing the job security of many employees, right? Because these type of employees, they do not have fixed employment. At one time they can work with a lot many companies, right? So this might invite some criticism from trade unions and some employees who are very up for their job security. That will have implications on job and social security of employees, right? And codes are likely to be passed quickly, will open the doors for states to maneuver them as per their needs. So states would be able to make some modifications according to their needs. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And if you did, then don't forget to hit the like button. I would be back tomorrow with some new set of information. Until then, take care of your health. Keep your studies going on. And I'll see you tomorrow. Thank you for being here. And goodbye.